know. You think he's got another one of those shirts? This one was used to wipe up paint at an art colony. But I'll take it. It's actually a white shirt. I ironed it. I do this every show, so let's get that away early. I've only been with my Kathy 24 years. So if you've been together longer than my Kathy and myself, please applaud. If you are sitting with your best friend on the face of the planet, please applaud. By the end of tonight's show, you'll know why I do that all the time. People ask me if Kathy really does have that wicked little sense of humor I'm talking about. Yes, she does. Like, she's laid down the rules. We met a group called the Perry Phillips Trio, and we were out exploring Kona, Hawaii with them. And the older gentleman that was in charge of the group, Perry Phillips, Mr. Phillips himself, said, you know, Kevin and Kathy, you guys are one of those couples, you can just tell, you're just going to be together forever. And Kathy goes, the only way we'll ever not be together is if Kevin dies of natural causes. And Perry said, what's natural causes? And Kathy said, like cheating. I'll never have to worry about cheating, because Kathy says I can cheat once, because you cannot cheat twice with three bullets through your heart. So, I got the rules. But this is my favorite Kathy story. She really does, she's very quiet, those of you who've met her. We sold our house in Charlotte, North Carolina in May, and then moved to Wilmington, North Carolina in one day. So I had to send Kathy home at the end of the Hawaii cruise for 2 weeks to do all the power of attorney and all that, because I couldn't leave the ship. So you've ever been apart from someone you love, and it starts out with all business, did you get the power of attorney on, how about the tags on the car, did you get those updated, and you get everything over the storage thing? And then because we're missing each other, it starts to, so what are you wearing? So I told her, your panties. And then I told her, I said, Kathy, I said, I'm really getting frisky. And she surprised me. She says, Kevin, I'm getting really frisky too. I miss you in the way that a man misses a woman. And I was like, damn. I said, well, honey, I'm really frisky. When you get off that plane in L.A. on Monday, you better have a mattress strapped to your back. She said, you better be the first fella I see. Now, we're back to the show. The relationship show on a ship is difficult to do, simply because of the age span. The oldest and youngest people on the ship, right now, there's some people that aren't here yet. And the oldest, I think, on this particular cruise is 97. At least that's what I've been told. It's amazing. Out of about 40 cruises, there's only been about 6 where we didn't have at least one 100-year-old. And it's difficult, because at different ages, you want different things. You basically become interested in a relationship with the other sex at about 12, 13, when you get frisky. From 12 to 13 to about 30, puberty till about 30, at least in the United States, males and females, all you're looking for is smooth skin, hard body, tight butt. Don't you women give me any of this crap you try to sell me on Oprah and Dr. Phil. I want intelligence and integrity and ambition and a sense of humor. I've got all those traits. You put me and Brad Pitt in that casino, who's getting laid? See, look at the females. That isn't technically a question, Kevin. From 30 till about 50, again, male or female, all you're looking for is somebody that is good at what they do. You want to be good enough at what you do from 30 to 50 that people who are good at what you do tell you you're good at it. Like if I tell Philippa tomorrow that she did a good show, or Duncan last night that he did a good show, they thank me because I'm a fellow entertainer. But if Duncan would tell Philippa that she was a great singer, that means a lot to Philippa because Duncan is a great singer. And that's what you're looking for. If you're a doctor, a lawyer, a mom, if you're a mom, for example, and you're your mother, and you think your mother's the best mother you ever met, and she tells you that you're a good mother, now you swell up and you feel really good. That's what you're looking for. But then it slows down. 50 to 55, you're looking for people that saved up. You've been in love, now you want the checks to clear. It's not a date now, it's a financial interview. Do you have an IRA? How's your pension? Is there somebody in your family's divorced that's going to take money from you later? I want to know all the things. We're going to move in together, I want to make sure. Where do you live? I live with my mom. What's she look like? Nice house? That's a good place to... Then it slows down again. From about 55 to 65, they become questions. Can you drive at night? From 65 to 70, they become personal questions. Have you had a bowel movement? Yes, yes, I have. Were you awake? Yeah. 75, they're back with the same questions you got when you started school. What's my name? So you get that out of the way, now we get started on the real relationship stuff. So tonight we're going to start with the things that I think you need to know. So let's get started. Very first thing is I'm going to teach you how to fight. And I know a lot of you are like, oh, well, we never fight. Well, then one of you is not necessary. So I should explain some brain chemistry before I get there. There's a lady named Candace Pert. Remember last show I talked about Deborah Tannen from Georgetown? Tonight I'll talk about Candace Pert. She's a brilliant lady. Used to work for the National Institute of Health. When she was in her 30s, she discovered the opiate centers, the chemicals in your brain that cause pain. Then in her late 40s, early 50s, she discovered the endorphins, the acephalins, the pleasure chemicals. So she's like a brain whiz. And she says that males and females produce chemicals that then produce the emotion. She calls them neuropeptides: fear, anger, melancholy, joy, anticipation. In men and women, we have all those, but we do them differently. According to Candace, females have all of the emotions always present, even if they're not expressed, if they're not feeling the emotion. Fear, anger, melancholy. There's 52 of them. Candace says there might be as many as 200. But women can feel them even when they're not feeling the emotion. Men aren't like that. We can make any of the 52, according to Candace, but we only got like one at any given time. So what's that mean? That means any of you females at any age can look around the room and tell that another human being is sad, male or female, even though you yourself are not sad. So a woman can feel a feeling she's not feeling as long as you felt the feeling she was feeling when she was feeling what you felt. But she's not feeling what you felt when you were feeling the feeling. She's feeling the feeling she was feeling when she felt the feeling she thinks you're feeling, the feeling that you're feeling now. So you felt the feeling she was feeling when you felt that feeling, but she's feeling the feeling she felt when she felt the feeling she thinks you're feeling that you felt now. And now she can feel it. I know a lot of you are like, well, what's the verb? Felt. Look at the rednecks. No, that's the green crap on a billiard table. You rip it out for $700 to fix it. Don't sew it because it'll lift the ball to the left. So you just put duct tape, it'll hop. Men are not like this. We actually have to match your mood in order to respond to your needs. And that's why so many women are angry. Say you're a woman. You could be sitting there crying, your mascara running, your hair disheveled. The man you love is standing in front of you, and all he's going to go is, you going to make me something to eat or what? Because he's hungry. He's not sad, but he saw sad, so he goes in the other room and he synthesizes. That's a fancy way of saying make. He makes that chemical and he becomes sad. Because when he last saw you, you were sad, and now he became sad, and now he's ready to talk about whatever made you sad. Except now, you're not sad. You're mad. He did not make mad, he made sad. You're yelling at him, saying he's insensitive, unemotional, doesn't respond to your needs. He's just sad. But he's so mad. So he goes in the other room. 2-3 minutes later, he becomes mad. He's worked his way up. He is now angry. And he comes back to be angry with you, except now, you're dressed to go out. Now you're sitting in a car driving somewhere. What's he doing? And what are you doing? I don't know why you're going to act like that. You're always so unpleasant. It must be that seasonal affective disorder. You know, we saw the sun most of this trip, so that can't be. They put like vitamin D in the back of your legs or something, because you're so cranky. Steve and Linda don't deserve this crap. You're going to act like that and yell at dinner? I mean, my God, you've got like 800 personalities locked up in me. Now, some of you are looking at me like you don't believe me. So I'll give you a better example. You ever been fighting with the woman you love in the kitchen of your home and the phone rings? They can switch immediately. You ever seen women do this? It's like a car wreck. We can't try it, so we just stare. You're right in the middle of it. I don't understand this, mister. Those are not your kids. They're not my kids. They're our kids. And unless you pitch in and help around here, I don't... Hi, Susie. No, we were just talking. Sure, I can watch Derek. What's he take? Ritalin? 25 milligrams? No. Ever watch a man middle fight, phone rings? We don't change moods. What? For you, bitch. So the first thing I have to teach you is how to fight. And I know a lot of you are scared of fighting, or you say you don't fight. No. Healthy fighting means you are willing to risk being hurt or misunderstood to get to a place where you understand more, or you hurt less, or both. Now notice I didn't say hit it. If you have to hit a woman to feel like a man, try hitting a man. That stuff will stop right away. Even a little guy like me at least get one nut on the way down. Watch old people, because old people fight correctly. They don't loop and they don't swear. We were outside the photo gallery, and there was a couple married 38 years. The only reason I know this, she said something ugly, just meh. And he turned around and he said, honey, we're on our 38th wedding anniversary cruise. Please, let's not fight. And they didn't. I didn't know that was possible. I found it for 5 days, Kathy and I. I didn't know you could just decide. Because my dad used to tell me, you never go to bed angry, like I could stay up for a week. Because they don't swear and they don't look. Now, that isn't the coolest fight I ever saw. The coolest fight I ever saw was between a deaf couple in a mall. I was in a mall with my daughters because I have daughters. There is no other reason for men to go to malls. We don't sit around going, you know, honey, I don't want to hunt. I don't want to fish. I don't want to ride in a boat. I don't want an airplane. I don't want to golf. I'm thinking about walking around for 6 hours looking for a shirt. Even if we get in the mall, we don't have the same skills. Women shop because they look and they compare and they get prices, they get the best deal, and it really looks good. Men hunt, but we hunt. We just walk in, go, ain't that a shirt? Well, hell, I'm out of here. I got one of those. You ever seen men and women at a round clothes rack? Women have physical skills. I didn't know about manual skills that we don't have. You ever seen a woman at a round clothes rack? They're like... And we're denying everything's right where it was. You ever watch a man at a round clothes rack? We just dump all that crap on the floor, put it on top of the for sale sign, and go, I wasn't here. But I saw this deaf couple fight. We were in a food court, and they were going at it. Have you ever seen a deaf couple fight? I had never seen a deaf couple fight in my life. They were going at it. He's in front of her, and they're like... Apparently, she had enough. She just closed her eyes. Coolest fight I ever saw. Wouldn't it be cool if we could do that? Well, I guess you people that have miracle ears, you just don't turn them on. We've been getting along the whole cruise. What? Look at the women. Is yours on? Look at him. What? Because I've already learned that women can hear much better than us. They can be three rooms away. If they've made you angry and you use that little word, she's like, I don't care. You're staying here until you get everything done. And then, when you get everything done, then you can go golf. Remember I told you we're like little kids? Some of you guys have fought in wars. Some of you guys have come back from combat. Some of you have started companies that feed your whole family and part of the people in the community. And you still have to get permission to go play. You can leave the house when you're done with your chores. What am I, 8? 8-year-olds don't pout, so you must be even younger than that. See, normally, women... You hear that? It was all women laughing because the men are looking straight ahead. I didn't say nothing. I was just listening to them. Dirty fist. They're amazing to me. I might have gone a little too far. Look over there. Is Kathy smiling? You know, I don't want her to slow down and stop making love 5 and 6 times a day like usual. Look at the people married over 20 years. That's a lie. That man is not telling the truth right now, I can tell you that. Some of you have been married 30 years. You're trying to add up. Let's see, there was April. Christmas. Didn't I get something for Christmas? I got something for Christmas. I hate to be the young kids. They're sitting there, is this going to happen to us? First 3 years of your marriage, you walk naked in front of your husband, and he's just going to go, You've been married more than 20 years. Put your clothes on! I can't even look in the mirror, because even if I'm naked and I look in the mirror goes, duh! Even the towels won't go around me. That could be my size. Oh, gosh. I don't know how I got off on that sidetrack, but that's the way my mind works. So I'm going to teach you how to fight. It's very simple. Don't swear. And you thought I lost my place, but stunning how my mind works, isn't it? It goes here and goes there. You should see me do a calculus problem. What's the angular momentum, assuming there's no wind? Wind? Where? Didn't do well in school because of the way my mind works. Kevin, what's the answer? I don't know, but if you rub your eyes really hard, you can see little explosions. Have a good day. Now, how do you fight? It's real simple. Don't swear and don't loop. That's my opiate. I told you, one of the coolest fights I ever saw, that 38-year-old couple outside the podium, he just turned around and he told his wife, she snapped at him, said something up, and he said, let's not fight. And they didn't. Now, I'm not at that level, but I can tell you what I've learned about fighting from people who've been married 35, 40, 50 years. If you don't swear, as soon as you swear, you can swear about stuff, but not at someone. So you can say, I can't take any of this crap anymore, because that's general. You can't go, I can't take any of your crap anymore. Unless, of course, you want half your crap to go somewhere. Because when you swear, all you do is you're angry. Well, whoever's being sworn at, nobody likes to be sworn at. Now you're angry. Now you got two angry people, and that's all that's happened. When you're angry, you're not thinking. Your brain is literally disconnected from everything except emotion. So if you simply don't swear, two good things happen. First of all, whoever starts the fight has to think about what they want to fight about. That alone will slow the fight down. Then the other person has to go look up the words. Kathy and I were fighting one night. She looked me dead in the eye and she goes, Kevin, you are infantile, puerile, and pernicious to this relationship. Of course, I'm a man, I got interested. Hey, honey, you know what a peccadillo is? She said, you're looking up pernicious and you found peccadillo? Scrabble players are laughing. Look at the rest of you. Peccadillo, isn't that a male armadillo? Look at the rednecks. No, that'd be a peccadillo. Little armor guy gets excited, can't run. You'll never get that image out of your mind again. You're going to be driving in Florida. Pum, pum. Oh, hope he wasn't excited. Except in Texas. Hope he was. That's how you fight. Now, once you learn how to fight, now I have to teach how to talk. It's very simple to talk to a woman. Shut up. Doesn't it make sense? They got five speech centers, a brain is wired into the chemistry, they got associated cortexes interlinked through the corpus callosum, all that stuff I told you last show. Doesn't it make sense they would need words? So when a woman says to you something like, I feel fat, for example, did you know they can feel fat? They don't actually have to be fat to feel fat, which confuses us because we need evidence. You can be 6'1" if you're female and weigh 8 ounces and feel like you're fat, which tickles us. Like the dancers, they're in our hallway, and if they're facing you, you can see them. And they talk about how fat they are. Men don't do that. I'm a man. Men put on 50 to 100 pounds before we even start to go, you know, I don't look like I used to. Take me, for example. I'm fat, I'm 50, I'm balding, I got hair in my back and fur in my ears. So I wear a Speedo. Damn it, if I can't see my weenie, somebody's gonna. And I wear them so little even men will look. Don't you women laugh, because you wear those, what do you call them, toms. Oh, thongs, that's what you call them. I call them thongs because that's what it takes to get them back out. And I got nothing against a bathing suit that little because I'm a guy. But I think if you're going to wear a bathing suit that small, there ought to be like a load limit. You're about the size of a Ford Escort. You shouldn't be allowed to wear that. It's like a car wreck. You don't mean to look, but you're like, oh my God. You can even get your wife to look. Honey, look at that. Oh. I don't see a tattoo. Wait until she takes another step. So let's just say, for the sake of argument, the woman you love says, honey, I feel fat. Now, if you're male, you're going to do one of three stupid things. Most common, you will deny it. Oh, honey, you're not fat. What is she supposed to say to that? Well, I thought I'd lie to you and see if it struck up a conversation. Second thing you do is fix it. Let me explain something to you males about females. If a male asks a male for help, help him. Solve his problem, he will thank you, you have a friend for life. If a female says, honey, I feel fat, don't fix it, because she will hate you for taking control of her life. So next time she says, I feel fat, don't ever go, all right, we'll jog Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Tuesday, and Thursday, we're going to come, let's start registering. She could have figured all that crap out herself. Remember I told you their brains are smaller, grown more densely packed? There is not a single issue in a female's life that comes up that she cannot solve. But if all she wanted from you was support, but no, you're going to try to fix it. And they hate that crap. And the worst thing you can do is answer. Never answer. If she goes, honey, I feel fat, don't ever go, ah, I could see how you'd feel like that. Even this ship ain't big enough for you to get away. So how do you talk to them? It's very easy. Next time she says, honey, I feel fine, turn off the TV, put down the newspaper, sit next to her. Those are all signs you're going to listen. And then just make sounds. After 15 or 20 minutes, she will get done talking about how she feels. The next 15 or 20, she'll explain how you caused us. Then she'll cry. When they cry, it's like us taking a dump. Everything's out. You feel better. You go line dance and get laid. Anybody want? Look at the women. That is disgusting. Look at the man. That's a genius. That's the smartest man I've ever seen in my damn life. Somebody is wearing obsession because my nose is itchy and I don't do any kind of drugs. So. You're wearing obsession? Oh, that's okay, Mitch. Don't worry. It's a beautiful smell. It's just it's one of three things I'm allergic to. One of the other two is money, apparently. Keep that around the house. I thought maybe. Don't worry, this isn't you. It probably smells wonderful on you. It attracted four women. Which every guy in this boat would pay money to see, but... Look at the guys in the back. When's that show on? Are we going to Tijuana? I don't remember that. It's very attractive. Sorry. See, there is a reason. I just don't stand up here going like this.
You know, you people ought to listen to me for the rest of the show, because...
No, thank you. I use the side of my pants like all the other men. She just offered me a tissue, because women have those in their purse, even if it's been used 800 times and it's 44 years old. They pull out the little crusty thing here. I have one of these. But we get them back, because if they run their hand on the side of that driver's seat, and ain't wax. Now I'm sidetracked to a place. The poor kid. Look at the poor kids over here. That's it. I'm not dating. I'm not getting married. I don't care what the hell happens. I'm not interested anymore. But I appreciate that. Very kind of you. I have a handkerchief, but I'm over 50, so it's somewhere. Oh, thank you. I'll take it. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Round of applause for our obsession lady. Thank you. Oh, look at this. This is monogrammed. It's got a rose on it. Oh. Does this have obsession on it? You just want the show to end, don't you? Can I keep this? Because you probably don't want it back. No, is this okay to keep? No, because Kathy will wash it. Look at that. Who did this work? This needlepoint. See, I've been on a cruise ship for so long, I can recognize needlepoint when I see it. When I was 20, I had no clue what that was. You can tell I'm over 50. I'm starting to appreciate things that people do and make. So after I clean this, it'll get framed for the lady that gave it to me. But thank you very much. I used it. It's because of obsession. I'm also allergic to large cash deposits, if you want to give me one of those. I got a handkerchief off the first one. There's only 2 days left in the cruise, and Kathy and I haven't eaten, so if you'd like to give me your cruise card, we could go to the big restaurants. And I'm just kidding. Does it look like I haven't eaten? That's why I can't go visit any of the poor countries to help out, because they're like, what did they feed him? He's married? What, is she blind? I'm just kidding, because Kathy thinks I'm attractive. She calls me her Greek god. I've looked them all up. The only one that even remotely resembles me. Little goat guy, plays a flute, hair in his leg. I don't care. She likes me. Which is why love may not be blind, but it's got myopia. I can tell you that right now. Because the other day we went to the beach, and I took my shirt off, and three helicopters landed. I didn't know it was a signal. It's just the glare. I'm just teasing you. Helicopters didn't land. They just circle. What the hell do you think that is? I don't know. It's the biggest damn penguin I've ever seen in my life. Because this is what I look like walking. All right, back to the show I wrote. So, I told you how to talk. I taught you how to fight. Now I'm going to teach you how to seduce a female. But before I do that, I have to do a couple of things. One of the things you have to learn when you're working with females is you have to learn how to be romantic. Because women love romance. That's why there's so many romance novels out there. But I have to give a little warning to both men and women about romance novels. First of all, if you're a female, stop reading them. We can't compete in real life, let alone with fictional characters. If you women actually meet a guy 6.5 feet tall, wide shoulders, flat stomach, tight little butt in the back, has a Armani suit, Gucci shoes, luxury car, yacht, sympathetic, understanding, compassionate, witty, charming, good in bed, gives you unlimited credit, that's, he's mine. Those are fictional characters. Now, if you're male and you don't know what a romance novel is, go to the paperback section in any bookstore, grocery store, or CVS, pharmacy, whatever it might be. Look for a picture of a pirate holding a girl in a prom dress with her boobies hanging over the edge. And the dress will always be torn in strategic locations. And his hair will be longer than hers. And it'll have a name like Sweet Savage, or Secret Savage, or Savage Desire, unless you're on the West Coast, Bruce the Savage. But see, we are lied to about romance. There's only one way to romance your female. And I won't give that away right now. I'm going to give it away at the end of this bit. But I will tell you, females, we fall for what you tell us. Flowers, chocolate, poetry. First year I was married, brought home 48 long-stem roses. Found out they grow naturally. I was in university. I had no money. Oh, thank you. I had no money. I spent half of it to buy 48 long-stem roses. Kathy grew up in a country in Canada. She said, you bought 48 roses, they're going to be dead in 2 days. We have no money, and you could have picked them from somebody's yard. Second year, poetry. Really good poetry. I skipped a couple of night classes to write it, and I put it in cursive to show off. Roses are red, violets are blue, you're cute. There's lint on the handkerchief. So now I'm allergic to obsession. I got little tiny hairs going the wrong way. It's a plot, isn't it? It's a plot. I'm just kidding. It's not linen. That must have been one of my hairs came down and went back up on its own. That must be the one coming out here. See, the women are disgusted. Look at the men. I wonder if you could do this. I have hair everywhere now. I have to braid my butt so I can wear my pants without snagging. See, some of the women are disgusted. Some are, you got the same problem, so don't laugh so hard, Harry. Even if your name was Harry, you'd be a verb and a noun. And an adjective, too, yeah. Wow, you guys are quick. Very few people heckle with nouns. Well, stand alone, sometimes they form a sentence. I wish you could see your faces. That boy's got a problem. I think he must have ADD. Nope, I can subtract. You take a D out of ADD and you can't add. You can sell it. Very good. Boy, you are very quick. Got another 8 minutes? Give you the mic. You just come up and have a little fun. So just got a handkerchief to wipe the sweat off when you get these dead silences you're not supposed to have in the middle of a comedy show. Great, now that I don't have hair, I can sweat apparently from anywhere. When I had hair, it only ran down my temples. It runs down other parts, but I'm sure you don't want to hear about that. I'm probably the only guy in the country who can do his own show and get a rash. So back to the show. So that didn't work. Wrote the poetry. Then I bought chocolate. Now this is before I studied brain science, which I've been studying for 20 years as a hobby. I did not know about the PEA pathway, phenylalanine. That is activated by chocolate in both males and females. But chocolate works different in men's brains and female brains. In a man's brain, chocolate can act as a mild antidepressant. If you're feeling a little blue, you eat some chocolate, you're male, you can feel better. That's why some men like chocolate. But it doesn't do anything for our friskiness. If you're frisky and you're a man, there's no substitutes. Females, chocolate actually, because of the PEA pathway, actually acts as a strong, it can actually change a female's mood. And if she's feeling frisky and there's no man available and she eats chocolate, it's like she went on a date. That doesn't work for us men unless the chocolate's shaped like a booby. So when I bought chocolate for our third anniversary, anything men do, we overdo. So instead of buying like little six-piece chocolate Whitman sampler to make her day, I bought that big velvet-covered heart box that weighs like 28 pounds. You have to have a roommate help you carry it upstairs. It has like five levels, and you pull off the corrugated stuff on the top. And I didn't even know women didn't eat chocolate like men. I didn't know they didn't just smash them all open until they find the one they like and then chew that one. But we can eat a piece and leave, because we smashed them all until we found one we thought we might be interested in. Women, once that chocolate touches their lips, that PEA pathway is direct, goes right through the olfactory nerve, to the, right up to the center of the brain, and they start, and it connects. And they can't stop. They're like, I can't believe you bought me 55 pieces of damn chocolate. I'm going to get fat. I'm like, well, eat 10! Because I didn't know that they can't even put their chocolate on the refrigerator, because once they've tasted chocolate, it forms a bond with their brain, and the chocolate will call to them no matter where they go in their own house. So if they leave the kitchen and go to another room, the chocolate starts going, come back to the kitchen, there's chocolate. There's chocolate on top of the refrigerator. On the way back here, you could stop by the pantry and get Hershey's chocolate syrup, and go to the freezer and get the deep dish double chocolate muck. Rocky Road mud pie, and put that on top of maybe Oreos or something crumpled up in a bowl, and then you could get the chocolate off the refrigerator. See, every woman in the room is now thinking about chocolate. I'll prove to you how strong this is. How many men know that you've been getting a mint? Did you know there's been two mints in your room every night? There's one for you, one for her. You never saw the other one, did you? You don't even know there's one in the room. Unless it melts to the side of your face, and then you feel her at 2:30, nom, 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 nom. And you're like, oh, she loves me. Honey, you haven't been like that in months. Oh, the chocolate's gone. Roll back over. Go to sleep. So here's how I found out how to romance my Kathy. Those of you lucky enough to have met Kathy, she's not like me. She's a very strong person, very hardworking, very what a neat person. But she has some idiosyncrasies. One of them is she wakes up immediately fully engaged in life. You ever met people like this? You ever had that misfortune? Yeah, they don't wake up. It's 5 o'clock in the morning, no alarm, no nothing, and there's no transition. It's, hey, how you doing? You want to do the taxes? I was just looking at our checkbook needs to be balanced. We got to get the kids to... At the other end of the day, the same thing happens in reverse. She can be having a blast, 10:30 at night. She's like, this is a great myth. So I was at university, and I came home from the lab late one night. It was like midnight, and our second floor student housing apartment, the light was on. It scared the hell out of me. I'd never seen Kathy up at midnight, so I took those steps two at a time, because I could. University? That's funny to you? I went to university 5 times. And then they said, you could graduate. I did. Oh, after midnight. Now you're correcting my grammar. You're in the wrong tense shift. You're using the past pluperfect, and that's obviously the future perfect. Look at kids under 30 that went to public school. What the hell's he talking about? Kathy's sitting up there. I'll introduce you after the show. Yes, she does, but she went up. Have you been wondering about this for the whole first half of the show? You talked to her in Amsterdam? Oh, going to Amsterdam. Well, I was... You watch daytime TV, don't you? You think they're allowed to have a caller and... I'll introduce to Kathy after the show and she can talk to you about that. And I'm sorry that I... Why aren't you sitting down here so I can get you to talk to her during the show and keep it quiet so I can do one thing up here? I'm standing over here now. spontaneously starts that one-on-one conversation with him. Who cares about those other 749 people in the room? It's just like the people that stood in line. I'm not doing that. I have to get to my cabin. Just kidding, son. I don't know where I threw that, but... Okay, you got it? Good. Wash it. Save it. You might want to just put it in here for a little while, just to... Oh, look at the people. Oh, there's gonna be a fight now. This'll be fun. She'll just stand next to him with that obsession all night, and he'll have an asthma attack, won't be able to breathe. It'll be funny as hell. And then when he's laying on the ground, she'll go, "You're real funny now, ain't you, Mr. Funny Man? Ha ha ha. Insult me in front of 700 people. Oh, look at that. Is that blood bubbling out of your mouth there? Oh, that's terrible. Here, let me help you. I'll give you some CPR. There you go, you little..." Just kidding, probably. I know what you're... I wish you could see the back row. They don't know what's going on. They're like, he just changed subjects or something. I don't know what happened. He's stomping on himself and everything. He's scared me. Oh, little fat guy. Maybe he lost it. So, here's how I found out I'm Romance Kathy. We are going to make it through this show. That's a 54-year-old man you have distracted three times. Look at the people over 60. I'd have been gone after the first one. I'd have been I live in a gated community. That way the golf cart will take me in a circle, and I know one of them's my house. Let me outside the gate, I figure I must be on the right side. Because tomorrow we're in the Bruges, so I don't know how to spell that. Then we go to Larva. Apparently it's a French city with big malls looking for a lag. I wonder if Cosby ever had a night like this. Maybe there's a reason he owns his own plane. He's the guy I think is the best, by the way. He's the Mark Twain of our generation. If we get enough distance and look back, we're going to think he's just profound as hell. Me, we're just going to look back and go, damn. I didn't think that lady was going to kill him. So here's how I found out I'm a romance cat. I came into our apartment on the second floor after midnight. Slightly. She's got every light in the place on. She's barefoot, pair of jeans on, t-shirt, sitting Indian style in front of the kitchen sink. Everything is out from underneath the kitchen sink, and she's crying. And I was scared out of my mind. I'd never seen her cry before. I was like, honey, what is it? She goes, Ben-Hur got loose and he's stuck in here. Ben-Hur is our hamster. We call him Ben-Hur because he didn't run around the wheel. He just dragged the wheel around the inside of the cage. Well, he's a chunky little fella, and he got caught between the spacers after he escaped, and he was stuck. And Kathy said, he's been there over 2 hours, and he hasn't moved, and he's cries are getting weaker and weaker. I think he's going to die. Well, underneath the sink is press board. You can wet your fingers and reach through that crap, and it's held down by tacks, not nails, so you can pry it up with your fingers. And I did. Pulled Ben her out. We made love on the kitchen floor with me holding a hamster. Because Kathy's idea of being romantic is to pitch in and help her when she needs your help without her having had to ask you for that help first. Those are women clapping because the men are like, well, how many hamsters do you need? I gotta get them over to the house. So, now my whole face is itchy. This is gonna go really well. That comic was sweating like a pig out there. I'm just gonna comb my eyebrows down so I can't see it. I won't be nervous, and then I'll just keep doing the show. Four times already, bees have come over to eat the caterpillars, and there weren't any there. Bees don't eat caterpillars, but I couldn't think of the word bird. Your wife university.
You can't come up with
bird.
You see me up on the outside deck. Ooh, ooh, ooh. What did you see? A boot, a boot. Because I work in a really big shite book. That's the first time in my adult life I couldn't come up with bird. Now the way my brain works, I'm looking at a bee trying to carry a caterpillar. All the other ones get to get pollen. This is why it's live, folks. Oh, man. Anybody seen my ego? Could have rolled under anything. About this thing. So now that you've learned how to romance after just a half an hour, I'm going to teach you how to seduce a female. Before I do that, I have to explain something about our chemistries. Women think that... I heard a woman at the age of 40 look me right in the eye and make this statement. I'm just as horny as a man. No, you're not. Very few women are horny because they woke up. We don't have menopause either. See, women think, oh, well, they have menopause. No, we don't. Women do. We don't. We never stop making eggs. And we don't lose testosterone, the chemical that drives us. When that starts at puberty, we don't even lose any of that until age 55, and then only 1% a year. So a 70-year-old man, which is the average age of death in America, except tonight I died twice already. That means a 70-year-old man has 85% of his teenage friskiness. Women are not like that. You hit 40, you're horny about the same age we are, 12, 13. And then that lasts until about your mid-40s, where you go through that little 8-9-year window where you're a heater. Where you put on a silk robe to walk through snow to turn on an air conditioner. Any of you men live with a menopausal woman, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You can tell if a man's living with a woman who's going through menopause because they're so timid. You ever seen them? They're in front of their wife. You wanna go to Sabbath 17s? Because they don't know which one of the 800 women is going to answer them. They're just hoping like hell it's one that likes to eat. Any of you men been asleep? If you live with a woman who's gone through menopause, you know what I'm talking about. You're 48, 50, 52. You're sound asleep. What do you get? Get up. Huh? Huh? Something wrecking a cabin? Something wrong with the kids? I'm hot. He wasn't hot. He was asleep. But apparently I'm hot to a menopausal woman means some damn man better go find some way to make her cold. 20 minutes later, he's sound asleep. What's he get? Get up, huh? Somebody break right now? Someone wrong with that? I'm cold. If I can't make it hot, you threw all the blankets off the damn balcony. What am I supposed to do? Because there was one of them boo-boo-boos coming by. We don't have that. Men are horny every morning about 10:30 and then every afternoon about 4:30, unless your circadian rhythm is nighttime, 4:30 at night, 11:30 at night. Women are not like that. You have 4 weeks. See if you women agree with me. 1 week, horny as hell. They like their body. They like being feminine. They like maleness. They like men's bodies. They feel feminine, desirable, mysterious. That's a good week. Second week, and this is where most young men mess up, so if you're a young man, write this down in a napkin. Second week, women do not want to make love with you. They want to be loved by you. And that's very important for them. They do not want sexual affection. They want physical attention. They want to be held, cuddled, hold hands, walk and talk with, sit and watch a chick flick with them. They'll wear a robe. They won't put on makeup. They'll cry. And they'll eat chocolate. And you just sit next to them and don't make any comments. If you hold off that second week, the first week, they'll do things you would have never thought of. I bought a Batman outfit in Holland. Third week, if you're the man, might as well be a plant. Fourth week, women don't even like themselves. I'm not wearing makeup. I don't care about my hair. I'm putting on a robe and slippers. I'm walking to Walmart and I'm buying chocolate. You got a problem with that? If you see the woman you love buying chocolate on her own in large batches, best thing you can do is back out of that room. Because no matter what you say will be wrong. Hey, honey, want to go for a ride? What, you think I can't drive? I didn't see the wrappers. I swear to God, I just didn't see the wrappers. So how do you make a woman feel sexy? You can't. What you can do is make her feel safe. And if she feels safe enough, then when she's feeling sexy, she'll explore that feeling. Let's say, how do you make her feel safe? Deep, slow, soft, passionate voices. That's what makes women feel good. Like Barry White. Remember Barry White? It doesn't matter what kind of music we just passed on, but it doesn't matter what kind of music women like. When they hear Barry White, all women do the same thing. They turn up the radio if they're not driving, they put their seat back, they close their eyes, and they go, he could put his slippers under my bed anytime. You ever seen Barry? He puts those slippers under your bed and he gets on top. You and the slipper's going to be about the same damn size. That's a big, powerful man. But what turns women on is the deep, soft, passionate tones in his voice. But we're men. All of us speak an octave lower than females on the average. They can hear an octave lower, so they can hear those tones in her voice. That's why you have what I call surprise fights. You ever had one of those? She goes, how was your day, honey? You go, fine. She goes, what went wrong? Well, nothing. Well, then why are you using that tone of voice? What tone of voice? Don't snap at me. I'm not snapping at you. Well, then what's wrong? Nothing. Don't you yell at me. I'm not yelling at you. See? It's deep, soft, passionate voices that turn women on. And we can do it, but we don't. Here's how most of you females get invited to bed by men who love you. Hey, babe. Halftime. Want to go around or something? We got like 10 seconds. Hey, do you think women are going to fly off the couch? I thought you'd never ask. What are we going to do with all the extra time? You don't yell at a woman you're trying to turn on. You seduce her. Lower the tone of your voice. Space out your words. And talk soft. And if you talk like this, you can talk about anything. Some of the women are looking at him and you're going, he's not that old. And all I did was change my voice. Now, who would you rather be with? Some guy going, hey, man, I'm sorry, I can't get that bird out of my head. I try not to laugh at myself. Thank you. Forget the end of that bit. It basically is the same thing, soft voices. Make sure you're with a man when you use that voice. You don't want to be golfing and go, hey, Bob. Could you hold my Woody while I clean my balls? You learn how to touch, you learn how to talk, you learn how to fight, you learn how to seduce. Now I'm going to teach you how to kiss. Kissing for women is the best foreplay. It can be a lot of things. Man, that's why women are good at it. And the reason I bring it up, kissing, is because it's the only physical act women at every age report they wish their partner was better at. From 12 till they pass on. Because kissing for females is important. It's a lot of things. It can be foreplay, it can be a sex act, it can be a way to reveal themselves to you, it can be a way to discover you, it can be a way to bond, a soul kiss where they're lost in the eternity, the moment of joy and sharing. And for men, it's an interruption on the way down. That's why we're not good kissers. We're like, you ready? You're not ready yet. How long does this take? Women are like, well, be more creative. Okay. Well, I know some of you are older than me, so it's We don't kiss well. We're either puppy dog tails, where we're trying to kiss you women, but we're like, women can't kiss us. How many women have been out that lizard tongue guy? Got it just darts in and out of your mouth. You're trying to kiss him, but he's... You're a woman, you think it's a game. Then you do catch his tongue. What the hell are you doing? The stuffer guy just knocks your tongue out of the way and shoves his all the way down your throat. Like if he could get deep enough, that would turn you on. And he thinks he's turning you on because you're making those little noises. You you're not turned on. She's trying to breathe. She can't because you're holding her hair. There is one more, but you don't date this fellow more than one time. You ever been out with him? The fish face? The guy that puts his mouth over your mouth, gives you that little signal, open your mouth. So you open your mouth, he opens his mouth. No tongue touch. You're doing this. After a couple minutes, you open up one eye to see what the hell's going on. And you realize both of his are staring at you. You didn't mean to laugh. I am way over time, so I apologize. I got to do two more things because they are the two most important things in all the shows. I'm again tomorrow night in the Vista Lounge. And there's only two relationship bits in that whole show because it's the history from my first joke to the most recent jokes that are not in these shows. And tomorrow I'll be studying really hard on bird. I'll never miss that word again. It's almost like those blankets that went by in Scotland. This is my DVD. It's for sale down there in the the birds are. Overall, I don't want to live anywhere that Kathy isn't. And it's that simple. And a lot of us feel that way. That's why you're still together. I still can't get over the fact that I couldn't come up with the word bird. That is really bugging me. It's a senior moment. It's like 400 of them at one time is what it is. I can't wait till I see a bird. It goes... Man. I never meant this at a Marillade. I thought it's just fun. It's all the stuff that... it's not all of it because now I do almost 4 hours, but there's like an hour on here. And we were doing a show out of Vancouver to Alaska 2 years ago, and I met a family of 10. The guy had 10 children. The 10 children chipped in to send him up to him and his wife for their anniversary up to Alaska. So they didn't have a lot of money. The children puzzled it all together. And he said, I would love to buy 11 of those for everybody, one for us and one for each of my 10 adult children, but we don't have that kind of money. We only have $500 spending money for the whole week up in Alaska. I said, just buy one. We'll burn as many as you need. And he goes, oh, thank you. He said, because I want to send one to my daughter. She's 37 years old. She's been married for 14 years, and she's thinking about leaving her husband. And he says, I want to send the original to her and then burn copies for me and the rest of the kids. So I thought nothing of it, and he got one and did exactly that. I heard from the daughter. I'd never met this woman. She sent an email to Kathy and I, and she said, Mr. and Mrs. Hughes, you do not know who I am. My parents saw you in Alaska. They knew I was having trouble in my marriage. They sent me a bottle of wine and your CD, and they said, please, get the kids to another house for a night. Go back to your house. Start a little fire in a fireplace, put the CD in the CD player, drink the wine, and maybe you'll listen and laugh. And she said, I have to be honest, I had not laughed with my husband in 4 years. Until I heard your CD, Mr. Hughes, I was thinking about leaving my husband. After listening to it, I realized he should leave me. So pick up as many as you need. Now, if you don't listen to anything else in the show, or you're young and you don't need this right now, but you'll need it in a couple years when you find Mr. Wright or Miss Wright or pretty close. Because if I was Mr. Wright... I need prettier clothes. What? Think bigger? Birds don't turn into bees. You're 9. You haven't even heard about the bird and bees yet. This is amazing. I got women giving me lace handkerchiefs. I can't say the word bird. Now I'm being outsmarted by a 9-year-old.
It's so good to be a comedian.
Now I'm going to go back to the cabin and Kathy's going, I'm not tired. I feel like fooling around. You got the Batman outfit? Wish you'd have told me earlier. You gotta be really good to bring your own show to a halt. I can't tell you how much that takes to stop the laughter. I'm just gonna struggle through the rest of it. Or you are. Okay, only two things. If you wanna make it more than 25 years, actually, if you wanna make it more than a decade, you only need to know two things. Rule number one, never marry anybody you love. Don't date them, don't move in with them, and don't marry them. Only date, move in, or marry people you like, and then learn how to love them. And here's why. If you love somebody and you don't like them, when the love is over, it will be over. Which is why men my age have to drive by houses going, I used to live there. You know why? You forgive your friends. You have no ex-friends, because even when you're mad at them, you warn them, and you tell them why you're mad, and the time limit. That's a true story from one of my life. One of our friends, my wife's church, we don't belong to. And their church was gracious enough to let us play volleyball there every Tuesday for 2 months during the volleyball season. As long as we didn't curse. One of my friends missed a little set, didn't spike the ball well, and he said, yeah, and they threw us out. So we only got to play 4 Tuesdays. We didn't get to play the other 8 because of this idiot. So all of us were mad at him. Like, all they asked us is not curse. That's all they asked us. And we could play every night. We had good games, good competition. Now because of you, we got Tuesdays empty for the next 2 months. We don't want to see you until next Tuesday. But if your lover makes a mistake, do you give him a time limit? Do you tell him why you're mad? No. You bring that crap up over and over and over until even a judge will go, of course she had to kill him. My wife's my best friend. What friendship and affection does keeps you together when you fall out of love and passion, which you will, same person, day in, day out. But they still have the same things that attracted you in the first place. Your friendship keeps you together to rediscover them, and then you come back and gradually gets more and more. Kathy's my best friend in the world, and she's had to forgive me for lots of stuff besides tonight's show. We were in our wedding night. We weren't in it. We... I'm starting to sound like an elected official. Apparently I'm talking. Makes no sense. We're going to get a new frame now. At least you get Schwarzenegger. It's not his first language. I've got no excuses. I was born in Ohio. Ohio. The Buckeye State. You guys need to ring a couple of them up here until I get my brain back. So, we're at our wedding, because we were both there. And my best friend got drunk at the reception, stripped naked, put glitter in his weenie, a lampshade in his pen, and ran around going, pull my cord, I'm a Bud Light. How would you like that as a wedding night fight? Kathy, gracious as always, says, Kevin, it wasn't your fault. Your friend was drunk, he was scared, he's losing you, you're getting married, he doesn't know if he's going to see it. Don't worry about it. But every year now, for 24 years, every Christmas, Bruce gets glitter from Kathy. The second thing is intimacy. A lot of young people tell me they're intimate because they're having sex. Sex is not intimate, it's private. You can have sex with anybody. You can have sex by yourself. A lot of us have. How many men remember having sex at like 14 with like a sock filled with shaving cream? See, look at the women. What? Look at the men. Remember? Sex will never keep you together. It will never break you apart. If it does, there's something else deeper going on. That's the real bottom line. If you want to know what real intimacy is, if you are lucky enough to have relatives who've been married 40, 45, 50 years, go to their house for dinner. A couple friends, a couple relatives. Phone rings. Does not matter if it's a man or woman goes to answer. When they pick up the phone, something heavy. A car wreck, traffic loss, biopsy. It doesn't matter. Something too big for human beings to handle by themselves. And what do? They're listening. The other partner somehow senses that. They don't have to say it. Their partner's not even looking at them. They're talking. What do? They excuse themselves quietly from the table. They go stand behind their partner, whether it's the man or woman. They put their hand out because they know whatever's happening is too heavy. That other hand is going to come grab. When those two hands link, whatever life throws at them, they're going to make it through it. So if you want to know if you're intimate, when you're scared out of your mind, your life's off balance, you don't know what decision to make, who do you reach for? That's who you're intimate with. In my case, happens to be my Kathy. Let's say Kathy got scared one night, like maybe she found her glasses. You don't have to hold back. I know what I look like. You put me in a pair of silk boxer shorts, I look like somebody shoved a Smurf in a pillowcase. Naked sideways, I look like the letter Q. It's going to take a while to fight that image off, isn't it? The last thing I'm going to leave you with is a little story about my Kathy. Kathy's not like me, very quiet, very polite, very sweet. But she is very gracious. And we were over at the Marriott Hotel in Kauai. Kauai Marriott, if you ever get a chance to go there, in the Willy Willy Harbor with the beautiful pool and then the big building. Just like tonight, after this show, I'll tuck Kathy in. She's not a night person. I'll go upstairs and I'll have my dinner. Can't eat before shows. Never have been able to. Just have a cup of tea in between. So
we did two shows at the Marriott. For whatever reason that night, because it was so beautiful, I think the bay with the moon and the cliffs, we went over to Duke's and we ate after the second show. So we're coming back to our room about 1 o'clock in the morning. Coming towards this big, strong guy and a beautiful lady. Obviously just got married. He's in a tuxedo with a tie undone. She's got the pearl dress with the train and the trinkets. And he's trying to sweep his new bride up and carry across the threshold. But in the Marriott, you have to put the key in and hold the handle down. So he's just smashing her head up against the door jamb. Kathy, being gracious as she always is, she said, would you young people like our help? And they're like, oh, please. And so I took the key in and opened the door for the young man. Kathy took the train and trinkets. He swept his new bride up, stepped over the threshold, gave her a big old smooch, set her down. Kathy gave back the train and trinkets. I gave back the key. They were elegant young people. They thanked us profusely. They went outside. We went outside their door. They put on their do not disturb sign. So we went into our room, which was right next door. And we put on our do not disturb sign. And 5 minutes, maybe even less after we got in there, that young couple started to make love. And you couldn't help but hear them, you know, because of the glass. So Kathy and I, we made love. Well, then 20 minutes later, they did it again. And we thought about it. And then Kathy goes, Kevin, they can't see us. And their bed is adjoining our wall with our wall headboard against their side. Every time they would make love, Kathy would start jumping on her bed and hit her butt against the wall and yell things, ram it, Big Bob, ram it! And I'd keep going, my name's not Bob! And this went on all night till the next morning. Well, next morning, we heard that young man tell his bride, get your purse, we'll go to the buffet. Well, I was naked. Kathy put one of those little terry cloth robes that they give you at the Marriott, wrapped it around me, took a half a bucket of melted ice water, dumped it over, made it look like I was soaked with sweat. She waited until she heard their door open. Then she opened our door, pushed me out in the hallway. I'm naked, robe is hanging open, sweat's dripping, and as soon as that young couple made eye contact, I looked up and went, your wife lets you go eat?
My name's Kevin Hughes. Thanks for staying up so late.